Okay, I just called the meeting to order.
And there are no minutes, but you will have them, I promise, by the next meeting. I'm going to be totally caught up, that is my goal.
The executive minutes that we will be reviewing and approving, are those closed items?
Yes.
They are?
Yeah, until you release them, until the issue has passed.
Right, that's my point. Oh, so just because you approve doesn't mean they're released?
Right.
Okay, okay.
I mean, they signed off on, then they're kept separately.
That's what I didn't understand. I thought once we approved them, they became, okay. Okay.
You have to actually vote to release them.
Okay.
Okay, should we wait 6:15 for tax classification?
Right, so you can go into other business until then.
No public comment here, okay, other business? Major project information session. Let me just say that I think we had a fairly good turnout, I don't know, 60, 70 people there maybe. We stayed till about 9 o'clock, so there's some discussion of the four items. No jumping up and down or throwing stuff or anything, it was pretty civil. I guess some people send in comments afterwards that I think Brian wrote down on one page to tell us, so. And I heard positive comments on it from several people, so. I guess I'd finally like to say I appreciate all the people that showed up there and to the four presentations that were made. And three of the four are on their website. Brian has put on their PowerPoint presentations. Well, there's a PDF file, so you can look at that. But the media was not there for whatever reason. FCAT didn't show up, and the reporter was not there, so.
I apologize for having missed it, but I was pretty sick. But I'm just wondering, was there a discussion of next steps on any of the four items?
No, not really, other than two of them are at a special town meeting coming up, but no next steps, really.
Okay, and special is this Thursday, so
right,
people Thursday. Get a chance to chime in if they want.
Right.
Okay.
Brian, did you want to say any more on that?
No, I thought it was a good meeting. You get some information out. And the Affordable Housing Trust will be on the special town meeting warrant on Thursday, and then also funding for the engineering for the merger of the two water systems.
And the complete streets was one of the four, wasn't it?
Yeah, the town center store.
In the town center.
Right.
And where are we on the application for that?
So there's three tiers. Tier one is adopting the policy, which we've done. Tier two is a prioritization plan. The funding for tier two, if you remember, there's $50,000. That has now been reduced to $35,000, and that's currently on hold right now. So we're kind of waiting for MassDOT to figure out when they want to release funds to additional communities.
They're being held, it's being held up
by
state budget issues?
I'm not sure of the exact reason behind it.
Okay.
But every time I email for an update, and they check back next week, and then I'll email again, and I'll check back next week, and I'll check back next week, so.
Okay. And what's the fourth item?
Town hall reuse.
Town hall, and that's, yeah, okay.
Still right. In the design stage there.
Okay, moving on to Green Communities, grant update.
So if you recall, the town still has its Green Community Designation grant of around $138,000, and that was for energy improvements to the school. And the main item that's being done is the installation of energy control measures to the school. And that is in progress. And that came in well below the budget estimate that was provided in the energy audit. And we've had the school representatives from the school district here to talk about what to do with that excess money, and they've floated the idea of switching over the lights to LED lighting with the remaining amount of money. And so that's what, there's a proposal here to do that. And the proposal will exhaust the rest of the Green Communities money if we so choose to.
And have they done any assessment in terms of what that will save us in terms of an electricity bill?
Yeah, they do. On the there's a document, Universal Electric Company. Yeah. On the last page there, the second paragraph, kilowatt savings of 37,000 kilowatts per hour, annual savings of approximately $4,334 per year.
Based upon present day kilowatt
based
costs.
Based upon, yep, kilowatt hours.
Okay. Dare I ask how quickly they're going to be able, if we were to approve this, how quickly could they move forward?
So I guess two things. They can, and it says on the front page, they can complete it by December 31st. I did have a conversation with Jane Fister, she's from DOER, and she would be comfortable, and that's actually one of the things here, she would be comfortable if we extended the grant, only for the purposes of wrapping it up and getting paperwork in. With my internal understanding that we want to wrap this up as soon as possible, I asked her, at what point would this grant, if it wasn't closed out, stop us from applying for a subsequent Green Communities grant? And she said it needs to be closed out by mid-February.
That seems very doable.
Yeah. So I'd like to do two things. I'd like to try to keep the December 31st deadline to get the work completed, but also not be looking down the barrel of a gun if we don't need to be in terms of the closeout and the paperwork.
And that gives them time when school's not in session for Christmas to do.
Right.
And do
right.
It.
And.
Well,
they'll also be lightly staffed. DOER will also be lightly staffed during the holidays. Yeah. If you know what I mean by that. So, in terms of trying to pull everything together by the 31st, you was recommending against it.
Well, I'm all for energy efficiency, and obviously LED is the future. And if it's going to save, you know, ballpark of $4,300 a year, up and down depending upon where electricity rates go, and it can be done expeditiously.
Yeah.
So the town, we can start realizing the savings, and the town can apply for the next round of grants and do solar or whatever we feel is in our interest. I'm fine with approving this if we're allowed to approve it in this meeting.
What's the second page here about?
So the second page are two modifications that weren't included in the original CTC proposal, and one is to upgrade the main building three-way valve to a complete replacement. And the other one is add solar sensor to the building automated system platform. And those were handed to me as recommendations. This is something the school district's consultant would also like to do.
That's part of the Green Communities?
That would also be part of the Green Communities.
And those additions would not put us over our budget?
Nope. The Universal Electric Company and this additional work from CTC.
And why don't
would exhaust the grant.
Why don't we have to go out to bid for this?
This would be a change order of an existing project.
So we're asking for $53,509 plus the $4,800?
Yep, and that will exhaust the grant, the Green Community grant funds.
Okay. Yeah, I don't see any problem.
No. Has the all levels of the school department reviewed this? Business manager's been involved?
Yes. I met with Bob Lesko and Don Skrosky earlier last week to discuss this. So the school committee's in favor of this. And I've also been in touch with Dr. Lynn Carey.
Right, so the administration's aware and they're ready to move, because they obviously need to be involved.
Yes.
From the procurement and all that. Okay. Fred, I would make a motion to, what's my motion, Brian?
Well, I guess approve these two items and extend the Green Communities grant.
I would make a motion to approve these two items based upon the Universal Electric proposal.
Yep.
And extend as absolutely necessary, but not to give us a, it's the holidays cushion, it's to your point, so that we make sure we do it right. But I don't want this, I want to finish this, because as much as they might say end of February,
right,
to, in order not to hurt our chances for another grant,
yeah,
you know, you talk to somebody else and they may have a different opinion on that. So I think it's in our best interest to do this as quickly as possible.
Okay. The intent is to get the work done beginning of January. I can't see going anything beyond that.
And then I would add to that,
you
might not like this, but I'd like you to have dotted line oversight over this project so that we make sure that it's done, because it is town money that we're spending. And as much as I know that they're also very busy, so if you're involved, just making sure that it gets done and moving, so that we can't look the other way on another grant opportunity. But so that's my proposal. But you got to be involved.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll second it.
Okay.
Who's in favor?
Yep.
Aye. Opposed? Okay.
Perfect timing for the tax classification.
Tax classification, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, because there was a public notice in the paper here on Wednesday.
Do we have to read it or not?
We should.
Okay.
Do you want to copy that?
You want me to read it?
Yeah.
Sure. All right. This was in the Recorder Wednesday, November 23rd, 2016. Notice, the Select Board of the Town of Whately will hold a public hearing on Monday, November 28th, 2016 at 6:15 p.m. at the Town Offices, 4 Sandy Lane, for the purpose of determining the current year's tax allocation between the five classes of taxable property, residential, open space, commercial, industrial, and personal property. For more information, contact the Board of Assessors. Paul Newland, Select Board Chair.
And you can see on the sheet, tax rate, recapitulation, the rates who were asking for the same rate, 1482 for all classes. So I guess the purpose is to agree on that, assessing all classes the same rate.
Yeah, one to one ratio, essentially.
Right.
Yeah.
Rather than the tax rate, I don't think this is a proposed, right? This is...
This will be definitely in the ballpark.
It may
change
okay.
a tiny bit, but...
That's not the final tax rate.
But you're right. The main purpose is to determine how the tax levy is distributed across the five classes of property.
Right.
In my 13 years, we've never changed it, and I don't see any reason to change it now.
Okay.
Would you agree?
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Okay, I make a motion to keep... to accept the tax levies as stated in this tax rate recapitulation document.
A second. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Just sign.
I just stand there. I think both of you probably should.
Yes.
Just anyway. I think it's going to eventually be electronically signed, but
right.
I'll have a paper copy just in case.
IT assessment and community compact.
What do we got, Brian?
So there is in your packet, if you see, there was an IT assessment from a Paragus Strategic IT. They came in and did a free IT assessment for the town offices through the Hampshire Council of Governments. And so what you have before you is their assessment of findings. And they have some recommendations on the back page. I think our IT infrastructure could use some upgrades in terms of backup, server, having some shared printers. Right now we don't share files, and a lot of their findings in terms of the actual equipment that we have, they found that it was antiquated in terms of the switches in some of the switches, the router, those types of things. Right now we have a server that's decommissioned and it's on the back table, but they said it's 8 years old and it's likely not, it's not wise to invest in having someone set it up, because that's about it, the end of its useful life. I wanted to bring this up and get this on our radar because let me back up for 1 second. I'll relate it back to the community compact. Once we submitted our community compact, I received a call from Mass IT, and they told me that the community compact had notified us that you need IT, that you're looking for IT assistance. So we had a good conference call. I told them what I thought our problems were, and they were going to put in, I had this call with them beginning of this month, they were going to put in a request with the community compact that the town be awarded a small grant to do a full IT assessment. The idea would be that IT assessment, at least in my mind, would be in anticipation of applying for the community compact IT grants, which pays for capital upgrades to municipal IT infrastructure. So I'm still waiting to hear back from the community compact program about that small grant award. But I mean, right now we have everybody's independent workstations. The backup that happens is on portable jet drives. A lot of the backups that happen are, you know, they're being kept in the offices, so we don't have any off-site backup. There's no central backup. So we don't have a working server. We don't have any sort of shared printers. Right now we have, you know, two copiers, and in order to use the copiers, you have to take your thumb drive and load up the file, walk out to the printer, you know.
They're not connected through a wireless component.
They're not networked, yeah. So to speak. And especially if there's grants out there where we can get some of those, you know, things hooked up, that would make our operations more efficient. More safe in terms of backup. And if we want to talk about security, I mean, I have antivirus on mine, but I can't guarantee that there's antivirus on the assessors or the water department or whoever's computer. I don't know if that's up to date. It's just really decentralized and fragmented, when in today's world, it probably doesn't need to be.
Would this system help us with, I mean, obviously we're volunteer driven. Would the proposed system, and I don't think it, having quickly read it over, I don't think it gets this detailed initially, but I think it probably would. We would want to make sure that we were secure with both town and non-town hardware. Again, we're volunteer driven. A lot of people do town work on their personal laptops or desktops by necessity. Yep. And that's not going to change. So I want to make sure that whatever we do, ultimately, the ultimate goal, and again, it may not be immediate, but the ultimate goal would be that people who are doing town work as volunteers have access to these, to the networks from home, the security pieces at home, and all that kind of stuff.
Right. And even the idea was discussed about the police department, and the highway department, and the fire department, and the library, as to having a shared location where all the files are kept, and people can remote in and access the files. And even within the office, myself and Mary Ellen, if we want to share files, we're emailing them to each other. So there are solutions for these things that have been around for a while. So,
right. I mean, I'm assuming that things like social security numbers are involved here because of tax documents or what have you, or is that not the case? On payroll.
That's an internet-based computer system that's backed up by.
So we're safe there at least. Okay.
Didn't we, when we were in the old building, Mark was looking at backing up to the cloud. Did that ever happen?
No, it did not happen.
Okay.
I don't think we were ready to do that. Okay. And that's what this is all, this
right,
is part
I understand,
of.
But if we did that, I don't know if that was...
Yeah, no, it never happened.
Yeah.
It's one of the options that could be explored, whether we have a server and system that's in-house based out in the back, or do we have something that's cloud-based, which is a server, many servers somewhere off-site that we can access.
They didn't make a suggestion on that?
They didn't make a hard suggestion either way.
Okay.
Yeah, I think you're saying, Jonathan, about providing this software and access to the employees and volunteers is a good concept, good idea. I support that. I think the other thing to look at, some of the software that you use here should be made available as well, because there are so many, you buy a package, Windows or whatever, that it's available on so many computers.
You buy multiple licenses.
You buy a license and that should be made available to people at town business.
Obviously the cost of the license increases as the number of people who have access to the license increases. But
right.
we should look into it all.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
What's the next step then, Brian?
Well, two things. I'll follow up with the Mass IT folks who I spoke with earlier this month to see what the status of that small grant is from the Community Compact Program. And then, let's say worst case here, we don't get that. I think this IT assessment will be the basis of our grant application in, is it March? March 1, the Community Compact IT grant program application is released.
Okay.
And the surrounding towns have, Sunderland's received a grant, Deerfield's received a grant, tens of thousands of dollars to make upgrades to their infrastructure.
So,
don't we have a committee that looks at computer? What is it, cable committee or something?
Well, we have our FCAT committee, but that doesn't look at, we don't have an IT committee. We should, I think.
I thought what was it called? Is it, I don't think it's called FCAT, is it? I don't know, Comcast, cable?
No, that's our cable access.
Cable access, oh, okay.
That's just the TV thing.
TV thing, okay, so they wouldn't have anything to do with this.
Yeah.
As input or helping us.
But let's paint the worst case scenario for a second. I don't think it'll happen, but let's assume for a minute that we don't get any of this funding through grants. It doesn't obfuscate the need to do this, though.
Correct.
So, and I don't know what the timing is to find out about grants, but I think since we're well aware that January is right around the corner and budget season's upon us, we need to put this into our FY18 budget.
Yeah, it'd probably fall into the capital planning.
Okay. And then we don't need it if the grants come through, but we can't not do this. We're at risk at so many different levels.
Right now we're making it work with the
with
the hope that in March.
But we're not being efficient, we're not maximizing our productivity.
We could be more efficient. Our systems could be more efficient. Yeah.
So I think you should sort of put this in front of the Capital Committee and say, hopefully we won't need you guys, but this should be one of the town's requests. And that means that an itemization needs to happen before Capital Committee meets when? Second week in January or something?
Around then,
yeah.
January.
So. Okay.
Hi,
Paul.
Hi, John. Hi, Fred.
Hi.
And everybody. Sorry.
New business.
Okay. All you, Paul.
We're on new business?
Yeah.
Okay. Liquor license renewals.
Got to take a shot at it. Mary Ellen's been coordinating the liquor license renewals, so I'll let her steer the ship.
Okay. We're asking for your approval for liquor licenses for the Castaway Lounge, Whately Inn, Circle K, and Muffins General Market. They have returned their paperwork, and so everything is in order for those licenses. I do anticipate I'll be getting the Quonquan Farm paperwork by probably tomorrow or Wednesday at the latest, which is the deadline. So if you're willing to approve those licenses tonight, those are in order. We do have some issues with FL Roberts' license, which we're going to be contacting town council tomorrow on,
and so I'll probably be asking, or will be asking for your approval at your next meeting for that license.
That, but you said the deadline's Wednesday. How's that?
They have to return the ABCC paperwork by Wednesday, and I'm sure I'll have that from FL Roberts, but we have some other issues involved with their license that we have to get worked out.
But you'd rather not discuss here. So should we, so we're not going to discuss FL Roberts tonight?
Right, right. But the other licenses, except like I said, Quonkwet Farm Anticipator, we'll have that by tomorrow. But I feel confident those licenses could, recommend in a way that those licenses could be approved.
Good. I would make a motion that we approve Castaway Whately Circle K and Muffins in Quonkwet based upon the receipt of their application and it being submitted appropriately. Okay.
Second. Okay. All right. Annual HVAC maintenance contract. Heating, ventilating, air conditioning, to be exact.
So you have the first page of the contract in your packet. This would be a renewal of the building maintenance services agreement for the HVAC system at the amount of $3,529. Grotsky is the one who currently provides the services to the building. We've been happy with what they provided. They seem to have, well, they do have a very intimate knowledge of the system. They were servicing it before the town purchased it. And I found them very helpful and responsive when we've had issues.
Good, yeah. I've heard nothing but good things about it.
What's the difference, one and two, in another maintenance program?
For under the agreement price?
Yeah.
That's first year, second year, third year.
No, about professional maintenance program.
Professional maintenance program.
One and two, there's an X
one
in the...
Two.
All one and two. I believe it's just the types of the items that are included within that packet. I'm not exactly sure what item one is. I have
maybe there are different levels of
maintenance. That's what I think. I have a list of the maintenance here if you want to take a look at it.
And what are we paying today?
It's the same price.
Same price.
Yeah.
First year.
Well, I don't know. A problem with that.
It's either we approve one, 2, or 3 years.
They're just asking for a 1 year.
Just a 1 year?
Yeah.
Will they stick with the 2 or 3 year prices if we decide to continue? Or is that ballpark? Because I'm assuming that's probably what it looks like. It's a 10% escalator.
Are we proven all 3 years? If
no, 1% is clear. I'm sorry.
Are we proven it for all 3 years if we sign this?
You mean if you sign this?
Yeah.
This is for 1 year. Is that your question?
Yes.
Yeah, and I'm just asking if they'll, if we approve this, will they?
If we approve it for 3 years, will they?
No, if we approve for one, will they stick with the pricing for years 2 and 3?
Oh,
as
ask.
We, because it's a one. It looks like it's a 1% escalator. So,
yeah. I can ask that.
Yeah, I mean, ask the question, but I.
Well, it's more like a 10% escalator. Yeah. $350 plus $3,500 is, $39, which is close to
$39,000.
No, it's $3,000.
No, $300. Right. I'm sorry. Yeah,
so that's
a pretty high escalator. So maybe we don't want them to agree to this.
Yeah,
it is a pretty high escalator.
1%.
What's with that? Give us a break. All right. Well, we'll go. We got a contract to sign, or what?
No, just one of you. Probably you.
Probably.
Okay.
Representative.
Yeah.
That was what was on the last meeting.
look familiar. All right, DC Pass prepaid account.
As you know, the Mass Pike went toll-free. So we're going to get Easy Pass transponders. How many are we going to get? Three? Two?
Honestly, I don't know. I don't know if we'll get one and multiple vehicles associated, or I don't know.
I guess regardless of that, we had talked with the town accountant as to how we might set this up, and said we need a vote of the board to establish essentially a prepaid account to set up the Easy Pass, because it's going to be, you know, it's because you're going to prepay it, and they're going to, every time you're going to toll, they're going to suck it out of your bank account. So.
You have one?
Yeah, I have one.
Me too.
Yeah.
Why does the town need it?
Instead of having, if any of the town employees go on the Mass Pike to trainings or things like that, or if anybody's going for town business to go on the Mass Pike, instead of having to use their own personal one and then put in an expense.
Or be billed directly from their license plate at a higher cost.
Right.
But it's my understanding was it's goes with the vehicle, not with the person, unless they have a different program. Because
it's a commercial transponder.
It's a commercial one.
It's a commercial transponder, so it will.
It's transferable to vehicle.
Right.
Okay.
But if you already have one in your vehicle, I mean, you're going to read it twice.
I guess so.
If any of us are going to a meeting here, it's probably our own personal vehicle. We're not going to take our town.
Maybe you can pull the transponder down.
Yeah, I guess you can.
I guess you can pull it down.
It's not Velcro. It's whatever it is.
You can put different vehicles on that account.
Yeah, but whatever it is, whatever the not Velcro, but it's the, you know.
It saves us from somebody having to say, I have this charge on the tolls and submit the reimbursement. It just comes right out of the account.
Okay. Sorry. All right.
Now, could employees, like fire department, if they were going to training someplace, could they use that?
As long as the vehicle is listed on the account that's being used.
Okay, sustainable materials recovery program grant.
We have a letter
take
from
money.
Take money. A letter from the Mass Department of Environmental Protection about a $7,500 grant for a compactor for the collection of mixed paper that the town has received. When you guys know the town received it, I did. I was in touch with Fran Fortino, and I guess fortunately or unfortunately, the cost of the compactor is not $7,500.
That was going to be my question. Is it higher, perhaps?
So that covers, I believe, about half the cost.
So we're getting a new one?
We don't have one, do we?
Well, they collect paper, but it's not.
But we don't compact.
We don't compact it.
So to your point about capital planning, I asked Fran to include whatever he thinks the cost would be in as a capital item, because one of the things I'd like to improve upon a little bit is our capital plan and have it a little bit more detailed as well.
I have a question about paper compactors, though. I mean, right now we have Quint crawls into the bin and pushes the paper and separates the cardboard. And all that. This compactor, I'm not even sure how it would work. Would it reduce the volume in the bins by so much that it would actually save us money hauling wise, or do they charge by weight?
They don't charge. They pay us
by weight.
So the fewer. I mean, that's why you try to maximize the amount of tonnage, poundage, whatever it is,
per trip,
because it increases our revenue stream.
Right, but if we have more trips,
there's a trip charge, right?
I'm not sure there's a trip charge or it's a...
Why else would you want to maximize the
There must be a trip charge.
Or
maybe you get a boat, I don't know. Yeah.
Well, I'm sure, yeah, we have to pay somebody.
So, but if you have a paper compactor, that means you can get more of it in.
Presumably.
But it dawns on me that how many years ago was it when we paid to have those bins revitalized because they were rusting out in the bottom, it was a Band-Aid approach, I believe. And because they were sitting in water. I'm assuming that's not the case anymore. But if the bin is going to go at some point because it's going to reach its shelf life, this seems to be an opportunity to...
Well, this wouldn't replace the bin. This would just compact the paper that goes into the bin, right?
I'm not sure exactly what it is.
I was assuming that it would...
But if the paper has to go somewhere once it's compacted.
Right, but I was assuming that maybe they'd come and pick it up and take it away. I don't know.
What
do they do with the garbage? There's a compactor for that, right? The compactor stays there, and they just take the container when it's full, right? So when this,
with the trash?
Right.
Yeah.
So this, wouldn't you think this would be the same?
I don't think so.
Right.
I think it replaces the bin.
That'd be a pretty expensive machine.
I don't know if it includes the bin or not.
Okay, we need more.
We need to talk to Paul about it. But I guess the point is we have the grant, and there's more money that needs to come up if we want to buy it.
All right. Do we have a deadline for accepting the grant?
I think they just kind of give it to us. It's whether we spend it or not.
Okay.
All right.
So you'll talk to Frank?
Yes, I will find out specifics from Frank.
Snowmobile Club Usability Park. I don't have a problem with that. I hope they got some snow, though.
No.
Because if they don't and they're driving the snowmobiles around Whately Park, that would be...
That's a problem.
A problem.
But they're putting this on the... at the bottom of the slope on River Road, which is...
Putting what?
The trail. They're marking the trail. Does it say?
Snowmobile Club.
They've got to mark the trail within our footprint.
But we don't own...
We own, you know where the third base dugout, the third base benches?
Yeah.
That's the pathway.
So this would be over that ball field?
Or hugging that fence. I mean, I don't have a good answer, but literally the fence where the players, to protect the players, on the first base side, where the bench that we have there is probably 4 feet from that fence,
right.
And that is the property line.
Right.
So the stakes would have to be
within there,
right there, or it's going to go. It needs to go into the outfield. It can't go through the infield.
Do they know that? Is that where it's
been? No.
I don't think it's been there before.
No, it hasn't.
It's been on other property.
Right, and we can't offer
other property
use.
Right.
As mighty and powerful as we may be, they've done this before, though. So. What's new?
Right, and it's been on this other property.
I think we just sort of, of course they can use Whately. Well,
if they choose not to use Whately and put it in somebody else's property, that's their issue, right? It's not ours. We gave them permission to use Whately Park.
I think we should give them permission to use Whately, but we should be so kind as to encourage them to be in touch with...
The landowner. Yeah.
From literally right behind the 90-foot diamond backstop. By 20 feet, all the way to the pine tree line, going south on River Road.
Sure. Okay. Duly noted. Brian?
Yeah. I'll connect with you.
Yeah.
All right, good.
Yeah.
Okay, town administrator updates.
So at our last meeting, I think, Fred, you had suggested we take a look at this again, right?
Right, we're going to list it.
So here it is. This is, I guess, dates back to probably my second meeting. And if you just want to run through it. What's in italics here is a suggestion for me that we might want to add these items.
Where are your suggestions from?
The ones that are in italics.
It's hard to see.
Oh, I see. I'm sorry. Okay, thank you.
Not necessarily in terms of priority, but, well, I guess I took a guess at that, but in terms of... Probably good to have these on our radar. And on the back, the back two pages, there's really quick, abbreviated updates as to what's going on.
I'm confused, and I apologize for that. I'm following your priority projects list. It goes 1 through 6, and then medium is 1 through 12, and then lower priority is 1 through 11. But then we jump to 16, 17, and 18. Are we missing something, or did...
One lower priorities.
Oh, here.
Okay, we now do them differently, I guess.
Yeah, you, John, have to go to active priority projects update, and then it follows.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, I got it. Okay.
Created a different list, I guess.
Too many lists.
Ah, okay.
I guess they're meant to be separate documents. One is really the list, and then one is a little bit more detail about where we are for your reading pleasure, now or later.
One thing I don't see, I don't think we're resolved, was burning permits. Fire department burning permits? Is that on here somewhere?
So I believe we did. John has pulled together a notice of the fine schedule.
Yeah, but we never agreed on that. He was going to come back.
Oh, he was going to come back?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you had...
No, he had two or three. Well, he proposed one, and he showed us two or three adjoining communities that had something.
Okay.
More there were prices involved, right?
Prices involved, and he was going to...
He was going to come back?
Come back.
Because I know I worked with him to finalize the document probably a month or 2 months ago.
Well, maybe you could get in touch with him.
We will.
He could come to the next meeting with the information to finalize it.
Yeah. Yeah, he had sort of the schedule of... Because he had his schedule of sort of first offense, second offense, third offense.
Exactly.
And weren't you gonna check with the attorney to see if we were...
But we did check.
We could charge them fees for the offenses?
Yeah, we did check the regulations, and it was, you can charge up to a certain, I think it's $250 or something, up to, for a single offense.
Okay.
So the town's... whatever policy the town wants to adopt in terms of anything less than that, it's free to go ahead and do.
Okay.
But yeah, I'll bring them back.
Okay, and something else we talked about, and I don't think it got resolved, was the kind of related liability issues of town property, and also the kind of related to use of the town hall and the center school.
Well, remember we did resolve that. We have power coverage, and then the organizations that use it, they'll either bring their own or we're covered for anything that's town related.
Okay, but I know Judy had presented a description of that one time, one or two pages of what was included in, or fees or whatever we could charge for town use.
Well, we did.
I thought we discussed that we were going to let certain groups could use it gratis. Right.
It was town use, but it was also tied to liability of whether it was a nonprofit or town use or private use. And we talked about liability, and I thought we were going to check to see if town liability policy covered a private group using, say, the town hall for an event.
I think that's what Jonathan was answering. I thought we had an answer for that.
I thought we got an answer saying that we're covered.
For town-related functions, yeah.
But non-town-related
functions. For non-town-related functions, right.
Non-town-related.
Private functions.
Right.
So,
I don't think we resolved.
I think we did, but I don't remember what we did. Can you check back on that? Because if we didn't resolve it, we should resolve it.
Yeah. Are you also talking about the building use policy, use schedule?
That was
fee schedule.
Kind of tied to it, because if it wasn't a nonprofit or a non-town event, then we're getting into the liability issue.
As an example, when the Cal Ripken Baseball League uses the small diamond at Whately, we carry our own insurance.
Do they have to have event insurance to cover them?
The larger Cal Ripken organization sells us insurance for any personal injury or anything like that.
Right.
And then we're covered by that. I'm hard pressed to think of that many outside.
The snowmobile club.
Stonefield Club.
Using the parking lot across from Zanoni's. We have proof of insurance that we requested from them.
There's a dance group that uses the elementary school once a week or something like that. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether somebody like Pete has ever, or Mary Lisensky's ever looked into whether their use is covered because they're a non-town function. Mm-hmm. My guess is they're not even an organized group. I think they're just a bunch of people who enjoy dancing.
Well, then I would think we would be covered. Our town insurance company policy.
We need to look into
this. Let me get the touch. I can probably,
I'm sure somebody
Maya or somebody will have.
Well, it might be in the previous minutes.
Something.
We might have.
If we're looking at the priority list.
Yeah.
Based upon the conversation of earlier tonight, I think we need to move the IT upgrades to the town offices to the higher priority, especially if it's going to be going on to the capital budget request.
Yep.
And I assume that once we get the money, we need to be very sure what we're going to be doing. I mean, I don't want to get the money and then spend 6 months trying to figure out what we're supposed to do. So I sort of think that should be in the high priority.
Okay. I think number 12 should be too, shouldn't it?
Yes. That was the other one I was thinking should be. Well, number 12 on which list?
Leading priority.
On this one.
Page 3.
Reestablishment of vegetative screening?
No, 12. Water systems.
But 12. 12? Well, I'm looking at the condensed list. Number 12 on there. Well,
elementary school.
Yeah, elementary school.
Number 12 on the activity priority list is water systems merger.
That's confusing.
Yeah.
I apologize. Okay.
Yeah.
But I agree with you, Brad. The water systems merger should go up to the high priority.
Well, no, I wasn't talking about that. I was talking about the elementary school.
Oh, you were talking about that. I'm sorry.
Yeah, vegetation screening.
Okay. If you guys want to.
I don't care.
I don't.
But I do care about the water systems merger.
Yeah.
Well, that's on the town.
Special
town meeting, right. and then.
Well, if it's on the special town meeting list, right, then it is a high priority by definition.
Right, so we might as well put it there.
Right.
Okay, so that's number 6 here, or 12, okay. Move that up, okay.
Maybe I missed the first part. You discussed town office renovations. You mean, so they're moving right along, right? I mean,
yeah, but we've got to apply for grants and wait for a decision, and that won't happen until midsummer. And then applying for either CPA or town money won't be till the fall.
I mean town office, not town hall.
Town office, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we're moving pretty well along in that department, right?
For those.
Yeah. That's the renovations we're talking about.
There's still the modulars.
Oh, and
the
then
modular
we got the modulars.
The
modular things aren't here yet, are they?
Not yet.
No. Okay. Do we know when they're going to appear?
That's what we're looking at.
Okay.
So
that in the safe, you or what, Lynn are involved in that?
Lynn is mostly involved in that, yeah.
Involved, whatever.
The vault, yeah. Yep.
And that's part of the renovations.
Yeah.
Okay. Renovations, okay.
So my quick look on this, on the active priority project update status that Brian put together, 8 community compact applied IT assessment grant to be awarded should be in the high priority.
Okay.
Water systems merger should be in the high priority. Establishment of the housing trust, we've met on that and they're going to be voting on it on Thursday, so that's in the high priority. And then the IT upgrades to the town offices are in the high priority.
Numbers I changed. Okay, number 17. Okay.
Because I'm hoping that 3 driveway permit revisions are taken off because it'll be a check on the box.
Right.
highway department electrical upgrades aren't going to go away anytime soon, and hopefully manganese is moving along. So I think that high priority can accommodate those additions.
Driveway permit revisions, where's that at?
That is pending legal review.
Okay.
I can go into detail if you want, but...
No, that's all right. No, I don't need to. Okay.
This, number 26, generator project, elementary school, that wasn't completed?
No, that was not completed. And we, I believe we still have money, or did that, did we carry?
I think we rolled it over, yeah.
We rolled over?
We rolled, yeah.
I believe there's still money allocated for that. But it's, really, there's been no activity for that.
Okay.
And it is something that, that I can restart discussions with.
Okay.
If we want to do that. If we could just talk about the water merger for a second.
Sure.
I had a conversation with Jennifer Sherrill. She's the USDA Rural Development Representative in Adley Amherst, wherever their office is.
Adley.
And we were talking about possible financing for the construction of the water, two water systems, the pump house and the connections. And they have two programs. One is called a pre-planning grant, which USDA would fund 3/4 of the cost of preliminary engineering and an environmental report for this type of project, public water systems project. The one catch on that is that that is really a precursor to you preparing to borrow money from USDA Rural Development.
Oh, so we have to borrow money?
They would like you to.
Yes.
I mean, yeah, they ask that you make a good faith effort to, if you use the pre-planning grant, that it lead into an application to borrow the money.
Okay, so by the pre-planning grant, as a result of that, maybe we get an idea of how much money we're going to have to borrow?
So, yes, it would be their preliminary engineering and environmental narrative.
I imagine after the pre-planning grant, then we have to do the planning, the as-built specs or whatever.
There would need to be some final engineering done.
Final engineering, which would be part of, you know, we'd have to pay for that, and then we'd have to pay for the construction.
So that would be the design would be a reimbursable under the loan, and the loan that you would get for construction is a loan grant combo. Part of it's grant funded, part of it's loan funded. Like most things, I asked, well, how much is the grant? And it's a complicated series of variables in terms of size of the water system, cost to users, median household income of the town,
right.
All of these types of things. And I tried to press her on sort of an approximate amount of what the percentage would be, but I didn't get anywhere.
Okay.
So it's another avenue to explore.
And there's no chance that it would be a forgivable loan at some point?
So assuming, so we'd have to take out a loan, pay them the principal interest versus do it ourselves.
Right. I guess the question is, we could take out a loan. If there's no prepayment penalty, we could avail ourselves of the grant portion of it and then pay it off however, whatever time.
Well, paying off a low interest loan from USDA is probably going to be less expensive than floating a bond.
Yeah, I don't know. I would think maybe it would be, so. Yeah. We need to find that out.
This would be, what, 20-year loan? 30? What's the term?
I believe they probably go up to 30.
Yeah, the question is, do we need a 30-year loan? Because it's right. The money's not going to be that exorbitant. That
we don't think so.
We'd hope not. Yeah.
The question is, we talked about this with the ambulance a little bit. Can you purchase, you know, can you make a purchase, avail yourself of the grant component of the program, and then pay it off?
Right.
So that's so you avail yourself of the grant portion.
How does this impact the the warrant article to, for preliminary engineering here?
That wouldn't impact it at all.
So if we approve that and went ahead with that, would that be a reimbursable item under the USDA grant?
It would be, it would be, design engineering would be a reimbursable item, but it's money that we're taking out as a loan, at least some of it is.
Oh, even that would be taken out as a loan?
Yeah.
It's worth pursuing.
So do we go ahead with the warrant article and take?
Yes, because we'd still need, even if we went through the USDA, we'd still need to pay a quarter of the.
And it's reimbursable, so you got to front the whole shooting match.
Right.
So you have to go to town and just hope that we get better deals as we go along.
Okay, so it's something I want to explore in more detail, but I wanted to give you a heads up about that possibility, because if we're going to go down the USDA funding road, we may as well take advantage of grant programs if they have them to save us money up front and maybe on the back end, but I don't know how much that would be.
Okay. Okay. Well, more to follow, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay. We're good with that.
Just two things quickly.
Yeah.
Three things. I have in my computer a draft Comcast cable license agreement.
Oh my goodness.
Really?
Yes. How many times have I said this? It should be ready for us to consider at our next meeting on December 12th.
Wow.
I've asked Joyce Palmer Fortune to attend the meeting as well. She's been pretty involved in the pulling together the contract. So hopefully we'll have the final one by the 12th. So I guess a question for you guys is Bill Solomon is a special cable counsel that the three towns are paying for.
Okay.
The first question is, do you think we need an independent review by our town council? Bill's suggestion is no, because it's so detailed and it's such a special field that it's not likely that the town council has had experience with cable license grants.
Sounds plausible. It'd be an extra expense, also.
It would be an extra expense.
Well, I don't know. I mean, we're paying him. He's essentially our acting council. So it's
right.
Like
that, that's
duty
sort of my sense, but
right. Plus, I didn't go over this contract at all, obviously, but
we're not on the hook for any. I mean, it's not like there's a cost to the town
right.
to be a part of this FCAT cable contract or the cable contract with Comcast. It's all a benefit to the town. There's no cost. So why would we spend additional money on something that really, there's no downside. It's just the only risk is not maximizing the upside from my layperson's perspective on this. Is that fair?
I think that's fair, yeah.
Okay.
And much of it is boilerplate across the municipal Comcast realm of cable license agreements. So I don't necessarily think that there's a need for it, but some towns have done it, so.
I don't trust. I shouldn't say this.
No.
Let's say that I would want to hold Comcast's feet to the fire however possible, get the best deal we can, and you know, I think that's what Bill Solomon's job is, right? To make sure that.
Yes. That's what I believe we're paying him for.
So. That's what I thought. So why would we pay another attorney to do the same thing he's doing?
That's what attorneys do.
Yeah, well, yeah.
What they get paid for.
And they get paid a lot, so I don't see it.
Right?
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I don't see
okay.
it.
Okay.
All right. Last item, I have two pieces of bad news and one item of good news. For the MIIA grants, we did not get the cameras for Whately Park.
Why not?
It just says no next to it. I don't know why. We did not get an award for the body cameras for the police department. We did get the award for the four backup cameras for the highway DPW trucks. So,
okay.
A grant of $2,500 to install backup cameras on the DPW trucks.
Has there been, have they been backing into things?
I've been told informally that there's been incidents in the past where things have happened.
Yeah, and body cameras for the police, I don't know. I'm not going to lose sleep over that.
No, but I think it's an interesting concept to pursue. I would have assumed that these grants would come out of Homeland Security or something like that, not Maya.
This is just the Maya loss control.
Yeah. Okay.
Program.
So, but now, if something happens, if we have property damage at Whately,
yeah,
Maya's still going to cover us.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so
I guess maybe they try to balance if we have property damage at Whately or we back over a car,
and they
or
can't
a
say yes to everybody.
Human being.
Hey, they're,
but
know, they're the beam cameras.
I'd like to. Do we have a quote on those field cameras?
Yes.
I'd like to. Well,
yeah, it's
that.
Essentially like a small commercial scale. It's actually not that expensive.
Let's follow up on that, you and me.
Camera system.
As part of the budget for next year and our wish list.
They actually weren't that expensive.
They're like $60 a pop or something.
I'd say just put up signs saying you're under video surveillance. Forget the cameras.
I see them advertised on BJ's site. It's like, yeah. No, it's like 6 or 10 of them for like several hundred, $400 or $500.
Yeah,
right.
This was $287 for like a six camera system with the DVR that records them. And they're not that expensive.
Right, so let's table that, but that's right. And then I think we should pursue other grant opportunities for the body cameras.
Why? Doesn't the
a variety of reasons?
Maybe we should ask the police chief what other options are there.
I've had conversations with him, and he didn't have avenues to payment for these things. But he's not opposed to.
Are the body cameras on all the time?
No, you turn them on.
And do surrounding communities have them?
Well, and you can turn them off too.
Yeah, but
yeah,
but
what's
when you're
the point?
When you're
we're going to do something
when you're dispatched
a little shady here,
when you're dispatched you're supposed to turn them on. So you could do a side by side of dispatched. Is it on? Dispatched. Is it on? Dispatched. Is it on?
Oh yeah. Okay.
I made a traffic stop. Is it on? All these types of things. So you can do that. And I think it's a good thing for the police to, I mean, I just think that they should want to have
it. There is a benefit to the police.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's keep looking into funding opportunities.
And that was around $4,500.
Yeah.
For a couple cameras. And
okay.
But for the backup cameras, let me ask, do we have them for the ambulance or fire trucks? Is there backup cameras on the ambulance and the fire trucks?
The ambulance system now,
the
newer
ones do?
Yeah, I don't believe fire trucks.
Fire trucks don't have, even the new one we got doesn't have that. It's got everything else. But
actually, the new fire truck might have one.
Might have one, yeah.
I'm not positive. You'd have to ask John that, but.
Yeah, okay.
I know Deerfield's new ambulance, they just spec'd out as one.
Okay.
I think it's positive for the highway department. They do have guys working directly behind the trucks.
Yeah.
So it's.
Yeah, I think it makes sense that's what Maya is going to have.
All right. Yeah.
Well, if you look at,
do our police cruisers have dash cams or?
I don't know.
I'm not sure.
I don't know.
You would think that would be an inventory thing.
You would think, and you, if I were a police officer, I know I'd want one.
Yeah. Right.
So.
Okay.
All right.
Moving on.
Is that it?
That is it for regular session.
Okay. I motion to adjourn regular session.
Second.
And then we have to enter into.
Okay. So I will read the paragraph. To go into executive session per MGL Chapter 38, Section 21A, Subsection 6, to consider the purchase and lease of real estate if the chair declares that an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the negotiating position of the public body, the board will not be returning to open session. So say aye.
Roll call vote, Paul.
I vote yes.
Fred.
Aye.
Jonathan.
Aye.